Hier om met my oor die Zille DA ooreenkomste gesels is Janja Nuber van die Sunday Times en Gwen Gwenya van die Instituut vir Rasverhoudinge. Janja, ek wil by jou begin. Was Christus se skikking die mins slegte opsie vir die DA?
Dit wil op die oomblik so lyk, maar ek dink die toekoms gaan leer of dit was. Dit lyk vir my soos 'n ooreenkoms wat nie baie goed opgestel is nie en wat verskriklik baie gapings het. So ek reken dat die tyd sal moet leer of mevrou Zille haar gaan hou aan hierdie ooreenkoms wat baie op haar welwillendheid steun.
Gwen, best of the least, you know, best of the bad options for the DA, what do you think?
Yes, I think at this point there were going to be no winners. So it was always going to be about how do we stop the bleed that's currently happening. And in those circumstances, I think the deal that they came up to was probably the best one they could under the circumstances, although I do question the reasoning.
So why do you say that? The reasoning?
Well, I think the outcome, as I say, is probably the best that could have been achieved, but how you then articulate the foundations of how you came to that decision is quite important. And I think the DA had two options, either to make it about a political and branding question or either to make it about the values of the party. And I think they're on the right track if you completely rely in terms of the branding, but instead the press conference yesterday, they started to go into the actual contents of the debate and the values without really explaining which ones were violated. So I think that area presented more stickier challenges for the party.
Janjan, jy het ook bepaalde probleme met die ooreenkoms. You said it was badly put together.
Ja, ek dink nie dis goed bewoord nie. Ek dink daar's gapings. Byvoorbeeld, daar's nie definisies oor wat byvoorbeeld politieke gesprekke is nie. Waaroor mag sy praat en waaroor nie? Wanneer word 'n politieke kwessie 'n Wes-Kaapse kwessie of 'n Wes-Kaapse kwessie 'n politieke kwessie? En die grootste probleem, daar's geen sanksie nie. As mevrou Zille nou besluit om hierdie ding te oortree, moet hulle deur presies dieselfde proses gaan wat hulle sopas 'n gemors van gemaak het. So dis dieselfde probleem, dit is absoluut op haar welwillendheid.
Do you think she'll keep to the deal, Gwen? I mean, Zille staying away from Twitter is anathema.
Well, as I say, I mean, I completely understand the politics of it. So I think if she does not, then there would absolutely be grounds to then fire her or to remove her from any position in the party.
You have been very critical of the treatment of Zille inside the DA, citing, for example, the fears inside and outside of the party that this treatment of her might close down debate within the DA. Why do you say that?
Yeah, I mean, for me, the character disputes were always besides the point, but really it was important that in whatever decision was made, that the precedent for the future was clear. And I think that in the articulation of how the decision was arrived at, the precedent that's now set is that, in fact, it's not because she violated necessarily only a political strategy, which I think on its own would have been good enough. But then they veered towards saying it's actually because of hurt feelings and offence that we are now closing this debate. And I think that sets a bad precedent, for especially for an opposition party, which might want to go into controversial terrein in order to counter populist measures by the governing party.
Janjan, in reaksie op Gwen wat geskryf het, the DA cannot venture into difficult conversations that might fall foul of public sentiment. Is dit nie tog 'n gevaar nie?
Nee, ek dink nie so nie. I'm going to differ from you, Gwen, on this. Ek gaan dit in Engels doen sodat ek, jy weet, verstaan word. But the point here is that it's not a matter of freedom of speech, as so many of her supporters made it, but of association. That is as much as it is. So I think when you join a political party, you sign up to stay within its rules and within its values, which in this case is freedom, opportunity and fairness, none of which surely can be associated with colonialism.
Gwen, I mean, what do you make of the polls that were published over the weekend showing the impact of the colonialism tweets, especially on black support for the DA, which surely matters politically to the
party? No, of course. And I mean, and that's, and I repeatedly, and I say again, that is the grounding on absolutely where the DA is strongest on this matter. It's been quite clear to say, you know, going into an election, there's a clear political strategy and you stood in violation of that, and therefore there's a political decision. But where it becomes problematic is if you don't wish to deal with the content, but then actually make it seem as though the reason behind the decision is content-based and not necessarily a brand strategy decision. So that for me is the problem. It's not a matter of free speech, because of course, I mean, it would be absurd to say it's a matter of free speech. She's written countless articles. She's clearly not being silenced. The issue is about whether or not how the party itself reacts to public sentiment that might disagree with its policy proposals. Because if you're going to say that we're only going to articulate that which lands well with the public, then you may as well govern by referendum and, you know, put out a policy or a poll on every single policy
issue. Okay, Janine, so how does one strike the balance between being sensitive to what your prospective voters think and say, and not yielding to their every whim?
Wel, ek dink dit is die hele uitdaging. Dit is die besluit wat elke politieke party moet neem. In the end, you can't be ruled by referendum, as Gwen correctly says, because you'll just go nowhere and you'll never take an unpopular decision. But I don't think this was at issue here. Ek dink waaroor dit gegaan het is ook die beheer van die party. Jy weet, daar's 'n uitstekende stuk vandag in die Burger deur Tony Leon, waar hy sê toe hy leier geword het, het hy uit die federale bestuur bedank en dagbestuur en federale raad ten einde vir Helen Zille as leier die ruimte te gee, to give Helen Zille the space to operate as leader without looking over her shoulder all the time. I think this is something that she should have afforded my money.
Gwen, so Zille said yesterday, remarkably, at the press conference, that maybe she should have left DA structures long ago. I mean, if she, you know, this can't be an insight which suddenly dawned on her. Surely she must have known that it's bad management to look over the shoulder of the new CEO, so to speak.
Of course, so this is a nuanced discussion. I think anyone who's trying to vilify perhaps liberals such as myself, who take a harder stance on the room for debate, would be misplaced to suggest that I don't think a new leader should be given the space to lead. So, I mean, I think that's a separate question entirely to how this particular matter is handled. So, and yes, ideally, a leader, you know, coming in should then step out to give space to the new leader.
And yet, Yan, even after what happened yesterday, the Business Day writes in a shocking editorial today that Musi is not in full control of his party. Which party leader in the world is in full control of their party? What do you make of this nonsense, Yan?
Well, this is, I think, where Gwen and I will find each other in that, in the end, the individual always, surely, is not robotic. So, elke individu kan daarom vir hulself dink, en ek dink nie die DA of enige politieke party, behalwe miskien Stalin se kommunistiese party, wil heeltemal vir mense sê, so mag jy dink, so mag jy nie. So, daar stem ons saam dink.
Gwen, what role did the EFF play in forcing Maimane's hand, if any?
I don't think any at all, but I think it is prudent as an opposition party in the EFF's place to take any opportunistic, basically possibility that presents itself in order to score points, and I think it's just done that.
Let's just look at some of the alternatives that were available to Maimane, Yan. So on the one hand, you know, this could have been a protracted legal battle. On the other hand, they could have just invited Zille back and say, we forgive and forget. Would any of those have worked, Yan, and then Gwen?
Well, that was your first question to some extent, which is this the least bad? And I think it is the least bad, because quite frankly, they couldn't just have gone on giving her the opportunity. Jy weet, dit was op 'n stadium het dit geword nie net oor wat sy gesê het nie, maar oor wat dit verteenwoordig het ook binne die magspel van die DA. En omdat daar baie kiesers is wat meen dat meneer Maimane eintlik maar 'n handpop is van een of ander groep wit jong Engelse mense, moes hy ook wys dat hy in beheer is. En wat die EFF betref, hulle bes probeer, maar ek dink in jou eie koerant op bladsy 2 het Jacob Rooi baie goeie onderhoud gedoen met Maimane, waar hy basies vir meneer Malema in sy kanon ingestuur het, wat weer eens wys dat hy besig is om beheer te neem van sy party.
I mean, from the outside, I would have said that initially, when that tweet was initially published, the prudent thing would have been for somebody like Musi Maimane to immediately contact Helen, ask her to remove the tweet and encourage other public representatives on Twitter not to fuel the retribution against Helen Zille, which immediately happened, even within internal party members on Twitter. But of course, I accept that this is my sort of outside analysis. Having spoken to some people in the party, they say that is misunderstanding Helen Zille's nature, and that even if she had been asked right there and then to remove it, she would not have done so. Now, I mean, that's a subjective analysis on people who may have working experience there, and on that level, I cannot comment.
On balance, Gwen, surely these people who you speak to in the party are relieved, right, that that unity, at least nominally, has prevailed, Gwen and then Yan.
I think so, but also, I mean, political parties change all the time. I don't think that this should be seen as some kind of irrevocable moment for the DA where it forever, from this point forward, decides who it is. It can decide that it is a party that is different now to when it was under Helen Zille. But similarly, in 5 years or 10 years' time, Musi's time again will be up, and it will be a time for rethinking about who the DA is at that particular point in time.
Ek stem saam met Gwen. Jy weet, dit is nie asof politieke party deur oop deurstap en skielik in 'n ander kamer is nie. Hierdie goeters gebeur met proses. Ja, daar's geweldige verligtheid, amper vir my soos ek net nou gesê het, 'n valse verligtheid, te veel van 'n verligtheid by DA amptenary en openbare verteenwoordigers. Hulle wou net die onmiddellike stryd laat eindig. Maar ek is bevrees met hierdie ding wat so swak opgestel is en met soos Gwen gepraat het van die feit dat partykeer die premier van die Weskaap op 'n Woensdag versoenend is en op 'n Vrydag aanvallend, dink ek hulle moes dit 'n bietjie sterker opgestel.
When you 10 seconds, what will be the big fault line in the DA for the next year? If it's not these tweets, you know, what will the big fight be about?
I think the DA often talks about creating clear blue water between itself and the ANC, and I think if anything, this is an opportunity for it to do that, because there is a very real political rhetoric that says there is no difference potentially between a DA that governs well and an ANC that governs well.
Thank you very much, Gwen en Janja. Bly ingeskakel, net hierna vind ek uit presies hoe aklige week Theresa May gehad het.